How many of you have done or participated in surveys? See? And how many of you have done RCTs? Okay, there's only one or two hands. So today we'll be learning about about concept and how to do a cross-sectional survey. The key areas is what is the concept of a survey, how to plan a survey, and what is analytical cross-sectional study. Okay. Many of you must be knowing the what survey means in a loose term. But as per the Oxford Dictionary, survey is defined as an act of viewing, examining, inspecting in detail, especially for some specific purpose. The Webster Dictionary's definition of survey is to query someone in order to collect the data for analysis of some aspect of a group in a area. And the epistemological definition given by Abrahamson is survey is an investigation in which information is systematically collected, but in which there is no intervention. So one basic thing is that survey or cross-sectional studies are observational studies. They are not interventional studies like RCTs. About the epistemological concept of survey, as I told you, these are observational studies. We observe the event, and unit of observation is individual. There are some studies in which the unit of observation is group of people or community. What are these studies called? Anybody? When the unit of observation is a community or a nation or a state. Ecological studies. In ecological study, we don't measure what is the blood pressure of every individual. We measure for a community. So in survey, we collect information about prevalence. Therefore, they are also called as prevalence studies. Sometime, if you repeat the same survey in the same population, after a fixed interval, say 1 year, 2 year, it will give you a continuous picture, like yesterday Ramakrishnan told about video recording. Okay, so this type of studies can give you the incidence. Example is surveillance, maybe. This kind of studies can answer certain questions. See, if I want to find out what is the prevalence of a particular disease condition in a city, cross-sectional studies will help you. I want to find out what is the prevalence of risk factors of CVD, how many are the smokers in this community. Cross-sectional studies are adequate for that, appropriate for that. Even how satisfied are the people attending particular hospital, such studies will be useful. So in short, these cross-sectional studies, they are useful for estimating the prevalence of disease or their risk factors in the community. And this ultimately helps in estimating the burden of that disease. It not only the disease, it also measures the health status. How many people are hypertensive? How many are smokers? How many are alcoholic? It helps setting up the priorities for disease control. These are also called as hypothesis generating study. The cross-sectional studies generate hypotheses because they are observational studies. Yesterday, when Ramakrishnan started and gave an example of the hepatitis outbreak, that was the first part which he described. It was a cross-sectional study, a descriptive study. And on the basis of that descriptive study, they developed some hypotheses that the outbreak of hepatitis was because of some problem with water supply. So that is a hypothesis, which can further be tested by analytical studies. And this last thing, if you do a cross-sectional studies repeatedly, we can find out the trend of the disease. Like in IDSP, the Integrated Disease Surveillance Project, which is being implemented in country, they have planned surveys for non-communicable disease risk factors every year. So this will help to find out the trend of these risk factors in the country, because they are going to repeat it after every fixed time. Okay. So what is the place of these surveys in epidemiological studies? As it has been told, these are observational studies. They are not interventional. It can be descriptive. It can be analytical also. Descriptive means just describing what is the prevalence of a particular disease condition. That is descriptive. Analytical. How can be the analytical case analytical cross-sectional study? What question it will answer? Whether the prevalence is higher in this population, this age group compared to other age group. It will compare. Basically, analytical means it compares certain things with other. So here it can be some other exposure group, analytical means. But they are always cross-sectional in logistic, in the sense that we collect information about outcome and disease at the same time. What we did in case control studies? We started with cases. Case control study, we started with cases. We selected controls which were not suffering from that disease. And we found out how many of them were exposed, how many of them were not exposed. Just opposite to case control study is a cohort study. We start with exposed people, we start with unexposed people. We follow them till few of them develop disease. But here, in cross-sectional studies, we observe exposure and outcome at the same time. So what kind of information can be collected in cross-sectional studies? Information about disease, information about exposure to potential risk factors, some practices, health-related practices like dietary intake, like cost and utilization of healthcare services, like healthy and unhealthy behaviors, physiological measurements, if somebody wants to do a survey to find out prevalence of malnutrition, he will measure height and weight of children in that area. Okay. So that will tell what is the prevalence. If he wants to do analytical study, whether the prevalence is high in a particular community as compared to other, it will be analytical study. So as we have seen, the logistic of the survey is always cross-sectional. We collect information about the exposure and disease at the same time. Logic, how we go? Logic in case control study was retrospective logic. We go from cases to exposure. In cross-sectional studies, logic is cross-sectional always. Or sometimes it can be retrospective also. How it will? I'll give you the second example. See, if I want to find out the incidence of measles in last year, the number of cases of measles which have occurred in a village in last year. So I will go to that village, do a survey, and find out how many of the children developed measles in last year. So that will tell me the incidence of measles in last year. So sometime the cross-sectional survey can also be used to find out incidence. But generally, cross-sectional surveys estimate the prevalence. How do we plan the survey? So most of you have done, you told that you have done the survey. Just to revise what you have done. First and foremost important thing is, for any epidemiological study, is you should know what you are going to do. You should set your objective, decide your study population. Third is analysis plan. Then decide what information you are going to collect. What are the data collection methods? What are the sampling methods, sample size, and data recording and processing? And we'll see all these steps one by one. First is the objective of the study. The objective can be if your study is descriptive, like for example, you want to estimate the prevalence. So that will be your objective, to estimate the prevalence of this and this condition in this area. If you are planning an analytical cross-sectional study, compare the prevalence of that particular disease in different subgroups. That is, those who are exposed or those who are not exposed. So prevalence of cardiovascular disease in smokers and non-smokers, or those who are hypertensive and non-hypertensive. That way. Second, once you have decided what are your objectives, what is your research question, second thing is, where are you going to carry out the survey? Is it a national survey, or it is a district survey, it is in a small village? That you have to decide. Which is, you do know any national survey which we carry out every
NSS?
The census is a national survey carried out on whole country basis. NSS is a sample, but census is the only survey which is carried out every 10 years, covering entire population. There can be specific surveys, like some surveys based on institutions or based in schools, or specific population, like somebody interested in HIV wants to do the prevalence of HIV infection in IVD use, injection drug users, or characteristics, some characteristics like in diabetic patients. Third is, you have to decide what indicator are you going to use in this survey. So define the indicator that is needed. And next step is to identify the information needed to calculate this indicator. Suppose somebody wants to find out the prevalence of dental caries in a community. So indicator is dental caries. And how he is going to get information about dental caries? By knowing how many of the children have decayed, missing, and failed teeth. So in this example, somebody wants to do a dental caries. This is an indicator. And information required is number of permanent teeth decayed, number of permanent teeth which are missing, and number of teeth failed. So he will collect information about these parameters for the survey. Many times what happens, you plan a survey, but your subordinate or field workers do the survey. This happens many times. It is not possible for you to interview or examine everybody. And therefore, it is necessary that all the investigator or all the field investigator measure the event correctly. So there should be very little inter-observer variation. And there comes the role of standardization. So you should, before doing the survey, you should decide how we are going to measure that particular characteristic. For example, if somebody wants to find out the prevalence of obesity, so they have defined, how are you going to take a weight? So weight is in underclothes, which exceeds by 10% or more of standard weight for age, height, in a specified population. So if weight exceeds 10%, then he is going to label that person as obese. So that is his operational definition for obesity. How are you going to collect the data? There are several methods. Commonly used is personal interviews. Field investigator goes to a person, interviews. In many developed countries, they follow this telephone interview. Record reviews, especially medical records for nosocomial infection. Structured observations, like healthcare facility survey to describe healthcare delivery. Or measurements. Just to give an example, for NCD risk factor, WHO has developed steps approach, where they measure height, weight, and certain other risk factors. Measurements also include certain biological tests or certain blood tests. Next comes sampling strategy. So till now, what we have seen, we have seen what is your objective. What is the second step?
Sample.
Sample? Okay, where are you going to do the survey, whether it is a district or a block or a state? What is the third stage? You have to decide what are you going to measure and how are, what is your indicator and how are you going to measure it. Fourth, how are you going to collect the sample and what are your methods. And now what is your sampling strategy? So there can be a separate lecture on sampling strategy. It is not possible for me to cover everything of sampling in one lecture, but just to give an overview of different sampling techniques, I have enlisted three important sampling here. And the gold standard is simple random sampling. You require a number of, you require a sampling frame. So what is sampling frame? See, here there are 33 individuals, 33 candidates are participating in this workshop. If I want to select 5 persons randomly, I will take a random number table, or I will ask computer to generate 5 random numbers. I will number everybody, 1, 2, 3, 4, 33, and the random numbers were 7, 9, 13 and 33. So this will be the 4 or 5 random numbers. So this is how we take simple random sample. So what do you require for that? You require a sampling frame. But sampling frame, if you want to do the same survey in a district, do you have a list of everybody in the who is staying in that district? May not be possible. It may not be available. Therefore, that is a limitation of simple random sampling. Other way is systematic sampling. Here again, you require a sampling frame. And every nth individual is selected sequentially. Cluster sampling, in which we select our clusters or communities with a technique called probability proportional to size. And selection of equal number of communities, equal number of individuals within each cluster. Now, these kind of surveys are extensively used in estimating the immunization coverage. And WHO has developed a 30 cluster method survey. So what they do, they select 30 clusters or 30 villages in a district. And from each cluster, they select 7 children and find out how many of them are fully vaccinated. So totally how much children they select, they survey? 30 clusters, 7 children, 210. So if out of these 210, 200 are found to be fully vaccinated, how much is the vaccination coverage? 210, 200 by 200, about 1995. So same thing is shown in the slide. Like there are 48 students in the class, and the name mark in red are selected randomly. This is a considered, these are the village, and they have numbered the houses from 1 to the last house, and they are selecting every 8th house systematically. Okay, but you should have such an organized community actually. And this is a cluster sample. So they have selected 2 clusters, and from each of the clusters selected 4 houses. There are excellent books available on sampling, and this is just overview of sampling. It is not possible, but if you want to do a survey or do any study, you will have to go through all these books. Next is, what is the sample size? I'll give an example of the same WHO 30 sample survey. What they do is, they ask you first to enumerate all the villages in the district. Say, suppose there are 100 villages in district. You enumerate 1 to 100. You write their population. So first village, say, has 100 population. Second has 1,000. Like that. Second column will be total population of that village. The third column is the cumulative population. What is cumulative population?
Keep adding.
Keep adding. Then you will have total number, total population of the district. You divide the total population by 30 because you have to take 30 clusters. Okay, so then whatever number you get, you take one random number. So suppose the total population of the district is 5,000 or 6,000. You divided it by 30. How much you would get?
6,000.
Yeah, 6,000 by 30 is 200. So you take one random number from 1 to 200. How much is that? Tell us one random number.
Say
4. 4. Okay, find out where the 4 lies.
From there, out.
Yeah. So 4 lies in the first village. So that will be your first cluster. Correct? Yeah, statistician. 4 plus 200? 204, that will lie in second cluster. Then again, third cluster will lie because third has a large population, 1,000. So the communities which are large will contribute more for the cluster. So that is probability proportional to size. The communities which are larger size will contribute more. So that is the concept. Next, once you have decided what kind of sampling you are going to use, you should know how much of the individuals you are going to interview. So for that you require the sample size. And for benefit of most of the people here, there are statistical formulas and statistical software available where you can put all different values. You can put expected prevalence, you can put what precision you want, and you can put the confidence level, and computer will give you a sample size. Those who are interested can contact Dr. Ramakrishnan or go to statistics books. But excellent softwares are available which gives the sample size. If you are going to plan an analytical study, you need to double sample size if you are going to compare, okay? Like exposed and unexposed group. So I deliberately kept this slide blank because again this is a very big topic, data recording processing. Excellent softwares are available for entering the data, and maybe before starting the survey it is advisable that you interact with the computer manager, data manager from your institute, how he is going to enter the data. And lastly, the analysis. So this is this study shows, this was carried out by one of our students in Orissa. He wanted to find out the prevalence of anemia and use of iron and folic acid tablets in pregnant women. So for that he selected 456 pregnant mothers. Which sampling he used, Ramakrishnan? He selected few of the ANC clinics in the district randomly, I think, and then the mothers attending the ANC clinic in 3 months were included. So out of the 456 mothers who were tested for their hemoglobin, 63% had anemia, had hemoglobin less than 11 gram percent, which was its criteria for defining anemia. So the prevalence of anemia was 63%. The other objective of his study was to find out what is the coverage of iron folic acid tablet and what are the factors associated for the lower or high coverage. So there may be a bias, like he is only taking mothers attending ANC clinic, but even among mothers attending ANC clinic, only 11% took 11% didn't take tablet for 100 days, which is supposed to be, ANC mothers are supposed to take IFA tablet for 100 days. And 16% told that they consumed a tablet only 90 days. So he collected information based on health workers' record. Like health workers told that 89% mothers were given tablets for 100 days. Whereas only 84% mothers told that they actually consumed. Okay, so he doesn't want to find out the anemia among pregnant women in whole of the district, every, so you need not take every mother, okay. Because it is not practically possible to village every to visit every village and find out mothers and take. There should be some sampling, some easy way. No? This is how the analytical studies data is presented. The same table like ill and non-ill. The data regarding exposure and disease collected at the same time. And what we calculate is the prevalence ratio here. Okay. Prevalence ratio is nothing but prevalence of the disease among exposed divided by prevalence among unexposed. So this is an example. I think the Orissa, I don't know whether the study is still carried out in Orissa. So on the first column shows the exposure, hookworm infestation. On the first row, second column shows whether the outcome is there, anemia or not anemia. Okay. 91 mothers had hookworm infestation, and of them 85 had anemia. 284 mothers didn't have hookworm infestation. 152 had anemia. Information about anemia and hookworm infestation was collected at the same time. Therefore, it is a cross-sectional analytical study. Is it clear? So, what is the prevalence of anemia among exposed individual? Exposure is hookworm infestation. Okay, 85 by 91. Prevalence of anemia among non-exposed? Very good. And the prevalence ratio is 1.7. What does prevalence ratio of 1.7 means? Yeah, the prevalence of anemia is 1.7 times higher among those who had hookworm infestation compared to those who didn't have. Another example. Now I am going away from Orissa. The prevalence of trachoma according to facial hygiene in Burkina Faso. One of our colleague carried out this study. Trachoma is the outcome. The facial hygiene is the exposure. Prevalence of trachoma among children who had dirty face was 54 by 391. And those who had clean face, it was 50 by 1509. The prevalence ratio is 4.2. What does it mean? So what is important is you should have clean face. Okay. The advantages are fairly quick, easy to perform, less expensive, adapted to chronic diseases. Several limitations. We can't tell about causality because we are measuring outcome and exposure at the same time. We can't say that this hookworm infestation caused anemia. It may be that after developing anemia, he might have. Okay? Not useful to study the disease etiology. Not useful to study the rare event. Okay? Because by the time you go the survey, the person might have been cured actually or died. Not adapted to severe diseases. Okay? So this is for the severe diseases. If disease is very severe and it is going to lead to mortality actually. If you do a survey, you will not find anybody with that disease. So this is the limitation of cross-sectional study. You don't know chicken has come first or egg has come first. Okay? Thank you very much.